some of the crew were just starting to bring off the last few cartons and the last few provisions to go aboard. The vessel disembarks from Renmark. Population of about 6,500 there. One of the largest irrigation areas in South Australia. Stream towards Lock 5. Early morning preparation for breakfast. Beautifully laid out. The girls certainly work hard on board. Sailing in a few moments. Last positions of the side being put back in. All provisions are on board. First officer just supervising here. We'll be ready to let go lines in a moment or two. Another unique way of seeing the Murray, pulling in by boat and camping. Quite a lot of tourists do that along the Murray. It's a lovely river. Doesn't really matter which way you see it. We see quite a lot of canoeists too as we go along. This area here, this is one of the irrigation areas. You'll notice that there's a pumping station there that sucks the water from the Murray up to the top onto the fields and irrigates the fields. By gee, I pity the poor chap that has to start that machine up. Certainly a lot of stairs there to come up and down. He must be completely exhausted by the time he gets back. There are some of those canoes we told you about. They usually have one or two man tents. They pull into the bank at night, set tent for the night, and continue on. Quite a lot of people do it right the way from New South Wales right through down into Adelaide. Yes, hello there. Make sure you have a safe trip now, won't you? This is one of the houseboats that you can hire. It'll take up to 8 or 9 people, I believe. Some of them take even more. But they have all the facilities. Air conditioning, colour TV, barbecues on board. And it's another lovely way of seeing the Murray. Again, they can pull into the banks all the way along. And there's some lovely reserves to see and some beautiful scenery. Hi. This poor chap, he didn't know which way to go. We were coming up on him pretty quickly there, and obviously didn't know much about navigation because we had a blast from the horn, and he immediately turned straight across our bow. We had to give him another blast, and finally he realised what was happening and pulled right over to the starboard side. Must have been pretty frightening looking back and seeing a vessel 51 metres long and weighing 1,300 tonnes towering down you. Just approaching lock 6 there. Unluckily we couldn't go through the lock, we had to change the itinerary because there was some work being done on the lock. The hydraulics apparently have to be overhauled from time to time. Our first stop on the edge of Chowilla Station. By gee, some of those trees are big, aren't they? Quite a unique vessel, can pull right into the bank. It doesn't draw very much water at all, Now, they have side thrusters on the engine to push out sideways when you leave. Those trees are overhanging the top deck. Gave everybody the chance to stretch their legs, have a walk around. And really get the feel of being out in the bush. That's how close we are there to the bank, as you can see. Only a matter of feet away. My wife, Anne. What are you looking at, darling? Ah. There's the lads giving a bit of a spruce up. They never stop, these chaps. They're on the go all day. Beautiful sunny day. What a unique sight, seeing that vessel just behind the trees there. Anne's holding forth about something there to a couple of the friends. A few chaps taking photos. Ah yes, it's exercise time. All the lovely food on board, you certainly have to watch your weight. It's very easy to put on 5 or 6 pounds while on that cruise. Well, we're ready to go again. Going back downstream now. And lunchtime today, we'll have a bush banquet. We'll be collecting some gum leaves and using those as decorations. And there'll be a swaggy's march. They're the side thrusters I was telling you about. It just pushes us straight out from the side. One of the crew is always left behind when we leave, and they use the runabout to come back on board. Quite a unique setup. There he is collecting gum leaves, and you'll see the boat, the way they bring it back on board in a few moments. Quite interesting.
Not many men there. All the fellows are standing looking around.
and allow you to do the action. The two main engines, both 260 horsepower, and they're also two generators too. They're both 200 horsepower each. Irrigation of the Murray over the years has brought a lot of salt, natural salts, back in from the runoff from the irrigation, and as you can see along the banks there are many, many dead trees from years gone by where floods have come through bringing the salt sediment. You notice all the way along the Murray there are many trees that have been killed by the salt. It is quite a shame. There are also quite a lot of day tripper ferries in the Murray. Pumping stations at Berry that's used to pull the water from there to the irrigation crops. Quite powerful units. They're placed all the way along the Murray, you'll notice, as we go through. Just coming back through now through Renmark and one of the old museum, paddle steamer museums there. A lovely old vessel. There certainly is a lot to see along the banks of the Murray. We're coming back down into Renmark now, where we left the day before, going downstream towards Purringa Bridge. We'll go through the bridge and on down to the next lock, Lock 5. Thank you.
that accommodates both rail and motor vehicles. Unfortunately, now the Australian National Railways have ceased the rail service to the townships of Redmond and 18 South. As you can see now, the centre span has been raised. It's reached the top of about half past underneath the bridge.
See there, the bridge accommodates cars and also has a rail down through the centre. Those big concrete weights that they use to counterbalance the bridge certainly are large, but the size of that. We're now just moving down into Lock 5. You'll notice as we get closer there too that there's quite a unusual system there for the actual lock and the amount of water flow that goes through. That's a rail that goes across there, and there's a little trolley truck that can lower and take out planks at each one of those gateways to either allow the water to run freely or to slow it down. Just entering the lock now. This is quite a lengthy process. We need to move into that lock and the gates will close behind us, and once we're in, then they'll start to pump the water out down to the level of the river on the outside of the lock. Once that's achieved, the gates then automatically open and we're allowed then to move into the lower part of the river. The river's partially in flood at the moment, as you can see that water rushing down through there. Level's quite high at this time of the year. They've had quite a lot of flooding in New South Wales. Won't be long now, and we're ready to open those gates. The water level is nearly at the right level. Here we go. It's starting to open now. It's a slow process. They're hydraulically operated, those gates. And they take quite a while to finally pull back into position. I'll let ropes go in a few moments and then we're ready to go. The manager of the lock just doing final adjustments there to the gates. All right, we can let the ropes go now. We're now headed for Berry. It derived its name from the Aboriginal name Berryberry, which means Big Bend in the River. It has a population of over 6,000 people in Berry. These two large car punts service 6,000 odd people that live in Berry. Right on the edge of the citrus growing area, a bustling town, has most of their Riverlands public offices situated here. Because of its central location, of course, the fruit industry also have berry fruit juices there, gardener canning fruits, factories, and berry estate wines. It boasts one of the largest wineries in the southern hemisphere. Quite a lot of old worldy type things too to see around Berry. Old pumping gear, some of yesteryear's farming equipment. There's a lovely old pump on the edge of the bank here. As you can see there, three-cylinder. One of the early models, 1921. Gee. Supplied 500,000 gallons an hour. Quite an enormous looking fellow, isn't it? Each day the gangplank comes up about a half an hour before we sail. We always have to make sure that you're there on time. They won't put it down again. Some people are getting a bit worried. There's one or two people that haven't come back yet. Passengers were very keen to go for a joyride. There's some of the oranges off towards the factory. You can see where their berry fruit juices gets its name from. Yes, trying to lose a few more pounds before tonight's barbecue. Hear that chainsaw in the background, that's the captain, busy at work, cutting wood. Everybody gets involved. The cruise director, all the officers, most of the passengers. There are quite a few passengers bringing back some wood. Everybody did their little bit. Half the passengers helped to bring the chairs down from the sun deck. There's the cruise director. There's quite a lot of work goes into setting this barbecue up. They have live music, a big gas barbecue area, a lovely big bonfire in the middle to keep everybody warm. There's the first officer. Ah, yes, and our trusty captain. A man of many skills. Yes, it was all over too soon. We set sail this morning for Loxton. There's quite a lot to see when we get off there. There's a couple of bus tours, one going to the historical village, or the hysterical village as the bus driver called it, and one going through the berry fruit juices and the canning factories. The water is absolutely still there this morning, a beautiful mirror image off the other bank. So nice to be able to pull in right to the edge and step ashore off such a large vessel. One of the many lovely little villages that we pass along the edge of the Murray. The local fisherman putting in his marks. I saw quite a lot of marks on the way along the Murray, where there were fish traps obviously put down below. There's some real scrub land there. We're coming into a nature reserve, or a nature sanctuary, all the way along this left bank. It's a game reserve. Only wild birds and the like, the natives, native fauna and flora. These racks that you can just see coming in to view now, they're drying racks. They're used to dry the vines and the grapes. There's some more of them there. Used, of course, after harvest time to I think the very well-stocked bar was used by about 99% of the people on board. Certainly was well-stocked. There's Bill in the background. G'day, Bill. And Nye Lewis, our music man for the trip. Certainly could tinkle those ivories. And of course he had a million yarns to tell. Some beautiful homesteads to be seen along the banks. This is quite superb, this one. Starting to move back into civilization again, coming round to Loxton. As I mentioned before, the river is slightly in flood. Start to cover some of the banks and overrun into little lagoons that were just creeks days before. See, there's a white mark there in that tree. Now that's the water level of the 1956 floods. As you can see there, it's about 18 to 20 foot up the tree. We've pulled into the bank bow first here at Loxton to let off the people that do want to go on the bus tours. Because the Murray Explorer wasn't tied up, of course, she had to keep the engines running to hold her into the bank. We've now just reached Loxton, a historical village. A lovely old village that's been restored. They're still putting pieces in. It's one of those type of setups, of course, that you can always keep adding to. Quite a large collection of old farm machinery just through the back there, you can see. Certainly brought back a lot of memories. Well, we're in our last lock. We've come back now through lock five. We're in lock five now. And we'll pull into shore just out of the lock on the other side and spend the night there. We've got a cabaret on tonight. And then tomorrow, back to Renmark. And tomorrow night, the captain's farewell dinner. Certainly has been a relaxing cruise.
Just to sit beside a girlfriend down at Henley, or take a quiet stroll through National Park, then to go and breast the bar at Jimmy Walsh's. You should see his face when you ask for a fortney dance. All the breezes blow across the flats at Kilburn are perfumed by the sewers as they blow. And the people living on the hill at Prospect say language that nobody wants to know. All the papers tell us there's a new world coming. The scientists tell us it is very near. But the only thing that worries us mostly is when we're gonna get more bloody beer.
Thank you. Straight on now to table 10, that was table 12. Straight on now to table 10. We've got a song from the table and a novelty song by Bill. So make table 10 welcome. Give them a hand.
I stand before you and not behind you. I would like to introduce to you the River Murray Muds. With great expense, I dug them up from the bottom of the Murray, as you would guess. We would like to render to you a little old song way back in the old war years. Kiss me good night, Sergeant Major, with me as the conductor. Table 10. In the
the first half of your act then, I've never seen Warwick checking over his sound gear as much as I saw him doing it just then. He was you had him worried, I can tell you that. Now, actually I must mention to you, and it's definitely not an Irish one. No, there was these two Lebanese blokes, Paddy and Mick, and on a serious note, there was this young lad walking down the street with his mother, and they were just wandering down the footpath, and there was a butterfly just flitted past the lad, and he just like that and killed the butterfly, you see. And his mother turned around to him and said, "That was an awful thing to do. That was terrible. You're not going to have any butter for a whole month for doing that. That's terrible." And the boy thought, "Oh, fair enough, mum's word. It's good enough for me." So they carried on, and about an hour later there was a bee just sitting there on a windowsill, and the little boy just went, killed the bee outright. And the mother said, "Look, that's awful. You just have to stop doing things like that. You don't have any honey for 1 month. You can do without it for that sort of behaviour." So the little boy, fair enough. They went home that evening, and he was sitting down on the floor playing with his toys, and the father was sitting there watching television, and the mother was working around the place, and this cockroach crawled out from underneath the chair, and the mother just went and killed the cockroach outright. And the boy just very snidely, you guessed it, don't you? The boy just very snidely turned around and sort of said to his mother, "Well, are you going to tell him or shall I?" From table 8, and I'm sure this is going to be a dig at gang or somewhere along the line, we've got the fitness freaks. Give them a hand.
Tried to milk her round the top rail in dismay, and the red leper eyed him in a stay there sort of way. Now said an old dead puller from South Yipland came along, and seeing Paddy Birch deny, he asked him what was wrong. Pat very nearly lost his seat and tried to look around. Said, my mail I just erected laid in splinters on the ground. My new leg rope is broken, which cost me 1 and 3, and the bail I dare say ruined, but I dare not go and see. And that blanky brindle leopard is the cause of all the row, and I'd like an introduction to the man who will go now. You would, exclaim the stranger, but let me make you known, the man who stands before you, my name is Neil Malone. I'll wage you while you're speaking, and he gathered up the pail to milk the brindle heifer in the yard without a bail. He turned to Pat upon the fence. Look here, old man, says he, if you bought a furrow heifer, you're sold as well as she. 12 years ago in Gippsland, when I worked for Jerry Gaff, I fed her from a bucket, she was then a tiny calf. 10 seasons there I milked her, till her profits began to fail, but I never had her broken to the negro or the bail.
That was very good, Eric. Thank you very much. Eric was representing table 6. Did you hear about the two Eskimos on a terribly cold night that they had? Awfully cold. Sorry about that. We've got an extravaganza from table 4. Sheik Ben Ali and the Nullarbor Nymphs in Turkish Delights, or Once a King, Always a King, but Once a Night is Plenty. So, make welcome table 4, the Nullarbor Nymphs.
In the Middle Ages, when the sultans ruled the Middle East, when the rich sheikhs, and way back in the days of Pharaoh, when large villages travelled in caravans across the deserts. Because in them villages there was always a chieftain. The chieftain was usually a very rich sheikh. The act I play this evening is that part of that very rich sheik. A sheik that has a harem, unfortunately, or fortunately in some cases. In my case, it's a harem of 7 wives. These wives, 1 wife for each day of the week. So consequently, they're named Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Now, I'd also like you to imagine that mysteriously and magically we've travelled through time to land here on this ship today. I'm going to ask you questions first of all. Is there any man, any husband here that's got more than 1 wife? Is there any wife that's got more than 1 husband? Right. Okay. Right. Well, that being the case, I'd like to ask your help, your assistance, because I'd like to show some appreciation to our captain for allowing us to come here today, this evening, and therefore I'd like to select one of our wives, to choose one of our wives to buy the captain a drink and give him a big kiss. Do you agree with this?
Yeah.
Okay, right. Well, at this stage, I would like to say that since I've landed on the ship, there is a young beauty that I've met, and this young beauty, who you will see later on, has decided a factor for me, which is I hereby divorce my last wife, last day of the week wife, Mrs. Sunday. And you will understand why when you see her. She's deteriorating. Okay. Now, my slave will be...
Pakawala slave? You got Pakawala?
My slave will be calling my wives in individually, starting with Monday, and he will be keeping a score of your applause. And the one which we all select will be the one to present this beer falls to our captain.
Great beer. Come on, Monday. Come on, Monday. Monday.
Yes!
was a great effort they put into that. You know the penalty for bigamy, don't you? Two mother-in-laws. Seven mother-in-laws, yeah. Have you ever heard an Arab like that with such a Cockney accent before, though? Do you? And he said, look, doctor, he says, I've got a terrible case of diarrhea. And the doctor said to him, yes, yes. He said, when did you first discover that you had diarrhea? And the bloke says, when I took off my bicycle clips. Now, on with the show, of course. And the last table, the last lot of acts from the starboard side, comes from table two, and they're going to do a selection of various items. So give table two a big hand.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I received a letter in the post the other day, and I can't make it to the table, maybe you will, and it's got on the top of it a misunderstanding of a WC for a wood chapper. And it goes something like this. Some time ago, an English lady was looking for rooms in a little village in Switzerland. And she asked a schoolmaster if he could recommend any. He took her to several delightful places, and everything being arranged, she decided to take one of them. Oh, there. She couldn't take it with her.
She could have stayed there.
On her way home, however, it occurred to her that she had not noticed any WC and wrote immediately and asked if there was one near the house. The schoolmaster, on receiving the letter, was much troubled, for his English being limited, he did not understand the abbreviation. Finally, he asked the parish priest to help him, and together they tried to make out what the lady must mean. At last they came to the conclusion she meant wood chapel. So they replied as following, Your Ladyship, I have great pleasure in informing you that the WC is situated 9 miles from the house, in the centre of a beautiful grove of pine trees and surrounded by beautiful scenery. It is capable of holding 250 people. It is only open on Tuesday at lunchtime, and as there are a good many visitors during summer months, I advise you to go early. Although there is plenty of standing room. This is an unfortunate position if you are in the habit of going regularly. But no doubt you'll be glad to know quite a number of people take their lunch and make a day of it. While others, they cannot spare the time, travel by car and arrive just in time. I would especially recommend your ladyship to pay a visit on Tuesday as there is an organ accompaniment. Friday night. The sounding is excellent and even the most delicate sounds are audible. And it was there she met her husband. Oh. I recommend quite well the rush there was for seats. There were 10 people on the seat I usually occupy, and it was wonderful to watch the expressions on their faces. My father has been there regularly ever since he was christened. A wealthy resident of the district recently erected a bell on their WC and it rings every time someone enters. A bazaar is to be held soon. And proceeds will be helping to furnish plush seats.
That's particularly fancy.
As members feel, it is a long felt want. My wife is in the delicate. She cannot attend regularly, and it is 6 years since she last went. It pains her very much not to be able to go more often. I shall be delighted to reserve the last seat for your ladyship. For the children, there's a special time so they will not disturb their elders. I thank you very much.
Table two. I think we might get Jim as Daryl's PR officer. What do you reckon? With the drinking song. Couldn't have suited anyone better. That's the end of our first half of our show, and I reckon what a jolly good show they did put on so far. Now what I'd like you to do is I'd like the port side only, just the port side, to give the starboard side a big hand for entertaining you so far. Certainly got a hard act to follow, but I think the second half is looking very promising also. So we're going to have a short break. And Jet is going to come up and give you a little monologue, I believe.
Seminar on the elementary rules of grammar by introducing myself. My name is I before E except after C. My interest in linguistics began at an early age and continued right through my life. I completed a PhD on the RSPCA, a BSc on the FBI, and an MA on the underwear. I then joined the ABC, WXYZ, and my life came to a full stop. I noticed with an E for exclamation mark that capital O for opportunity was knocking on my door. And I discovered the wonderful world of punctuation. As a child, my parentheses were very strict. E.g., I was 10 years of age before I was told what a comma was. One day, my father bought me a bicycle, but wouldn't let me use the punctuation kit. I suffered from pronounced dejection. One day at school behind a shelter shed, some of my school friends showed me a copy of the Oxford Shortened Dictionary. He opened it at the centerfold. It was vowel. Three full stops to a sentence, four-letter paragraphs, independent clauses joined by a comma. You should have seen the position those young verbs were in. It was disgusting. A few months later, something strange started happening to me. My P's and Q's dropped, and I had reached parody. One night, my mother caught me dictating in bed. It was so embarrassing, I was sent to correction school. But I managed to smuggle in a few cans of alphabet soup. One day, my parents wrote me a letter. It was a W, you see. Their letters were always to the point. But I did manage to smuggle in a can of alphabet soup, just to give me some fun. While I was there, I met Colin. He was aboard at the Slate. And with him, I made a getaway. But as we were running down the street, he was hit and killed by a speeding truck. I remember calling out to him, "Watch out for the semi, Colin!" At the funeral, his brother Mark read the eulogy. I later said, "That was a nice quotation, Mark." The pall bearers were Folio and Quarto, a couple of italics from down the road. Later on, I teamed up with a Greek lad. His name was Conjunction. He was a hippie, hair a syringe and used to inject opium. He was living in Kew. One night he offered me a J, but I refused because his father was a D and I didn't want capital punishment. Once, Con's father found punctuation marks on his son's forearm, and Con went before the High Court, but luckily only received a short sentence. While he was in the pen, he contracted a singular case of pleurisy and broke out in little yellow apostrophes. There was no anecdote. He died of a typographical error. It was a real trilogy. Then, I was alone. First person singular. My past was tense. All my friends were married, but I was still syllable. So I finally asked Doc for a date. She agreed and went to the public library. But as she was getting a book off the top shelf, I looked up her family tree. Prepositioned her hand in marriage. She agreed and we were married the very next day. We booked a trip overseas and spent our honeymoon in brackets. But we had to abbreviate our trip when Dot became predicate. But that's all for now because I've got a dash. Well, that was table one take. I think give the whole table another round of applause. Thank you very much. Moving right along now, we come to table three. And of course, we've got our birthday boy on table three. Rufus is going to give you a special item. Rufus.
Ladies and gentlemen, in relation to the ceremony of Tuesday, I wish to present you with the net results of the day. There she is, my little black baby. I will try with nice, great help to sing a little song to my baby.
The two Englishmen, did you? No. That were actually forgers. And one night they had a bit of a rough barbecue night, and they accidentally made £1 million worth of 18-pound notes. So they thought, how can we get rid of these 18-pound notes? And then one of them had a brainwave. Who'd be silly enough to take an 18-pound note? So they thought, right, they packed their bags, took all their money in some cases, and off to Dublin, on Aer Lingus. So they got over there and they thought, well, we'll organise ourselves a hotel. We might be able to just slip a couple in and just see how they go down. So they went into this hotel and walked up to the bar and
the barman was working away, and one of the blokes said, "Can I have a couple of pints of Guinness, please?" And the Irishman said, "Certainly, sir." Well, I can't keep that accent up for long. And the Englishman said, "Could you change an 18-pound note?" And the Irishman, quick as a flash, says, "Certainly I can." He says, "What would you like, 2 9s or 3 6s? Something special for you now, because we've got a bit of a magician on board. Daryl is going to come up and do a little trick here for you. He'll start setting it up in a second. I'll explain to you what he's going to do. Never before being performed in front of a live audience, has it, Daryl? And on national television this evening through the O10 network, compliments of Warwick. While he's setting that up, I'll tell you a little story about poor old Paddy. He got himself into some strife once he got his ear and his fingers back. And he was taken in on a suspected rape charge. So they thought the only way to find out if Paddy's really guilty or not would be to put him in a lineup. So they did that. They got 9 other chaps in, put Paddy in the lineup, and called in this poor girl who'd been raped. And she walked into the room, and as soon as she walked in, Paddy said, "Yep, that's her, I'd recognise her anywhere." Now what Daryl's going to do, as you can see, just because you've heard it before, as you can see, he's got 10 glasses of water here at the back and 2 at the front for balance. Good Murray water, yeah, you can see that. It's probably gin. We've got these 10 glasses of water. He's put a tray on top of the glasses, and he's standing some empty matchboxes on top of the tray. Well, you can all see that anyway, can't you? But what he's going to do then is sit an egg and lay a real egg too. Yeah, definitely real eggs. They're not hard boiled or anything like that. He's going to sit the eggs on top of the matchbox, and then, without touching any of it whatsoever, he's going to put the eggs into the glasses of water. All right? Now, I told you about the dry cleaning service tomorrow at Berry for tables 1 and 2. I'll tell you all about that tomorrow. The company will probably fork out something like that, but see how we go. Now, he's never succeeded this before.
Still itching.
You'll note the precision with which he sets it up.
Bang guys have breakfast.
You guys have breakfast.
You've got 2 choices, scrambled or poached.
Scrambled with matches.
Omelette.
With that blue one, I love it, the sauce.
Tables 1 and 2, if you were really quick, you could probably catch them on plates. Right, now we'll have to have absolute silence, please, because he concentrates very, very deeply here.
Don't now, Daryl.
You reckon he can do it?
No.
Roll up drums.
I told you they were real eggs, didn't I? You didn't believe me. No, in all fairness to Daryl, that's the first time that he hasn't succeeded in doing that trick. He's done it consistently every week for ages now, but that's the first time he's ever had a mishap. So count yourselves lucky. Would you like to see him have another try at that?
the question.
Has the captain got enough eggs on board?
All right, he's going to have another go because we've got to get this right. It's just—it's honestly, it must be the television camera or something. He's gone to pieces. This is serious. I'm only here tonight because my mother's Irish. She really is. She's the one that tells me all these jokes, and that's true. No, my father's the Scotsman. Yeah. He makes her grenades and she throws them. That's true. Because the only reason I'm here is because my mother, quite a few years back, went onto that contradictive pill. You know the? Yeah. Yeah, she got the pill and thought she did the right thing and slipped it into my father's cocoa and away they went. While they're setting that up, I'll tell you about the two Irishmen that went for the job at the mine. And they went in for these interviews. Neither of them had any experience whatsoever in mining. But they went along, and the first bloke went in for his interview, and the boss said, right, he said, what's the furthest down that you've mined? And the Irishman says, oh, 500 feet. And the bloke thought, oh, that's not bad. Yeah, we'll take you on anyway, we'll give it a try. So he was overjoyed and ran outside and said to his mate, look, I've got the job, but you'd better make it sound a bit better. I told him 500 feet, say a bit deeper, because he wasn't really impressed. So his mate walked in there and the bloke said to him, right, he says, what experience have you had and how far down have you been working in the mine? And young Mick says, well, he says, I've worked down 5,000 feet. And the boss says, gee whiz, that's incredible. He says, what sort of lighting did you use at that depth? And the Irishman says, oh, no. He says, I did the day shift.
Yes.
Right, we're going to have another cracker at this time. Excuse the expression. And we're using good Murray water just for luck. It's like dry ginger, isn't it?
Thank you.
Now, let's get back on with the show. That was Daryl's trick, the second time. Table 7, now we're going to have with a song. So give Table 7 a big hand.
Tea. Chalky's nose began to twitch. I say, my dear, said the colonel's wife, your barbecue's burnt to pitch. Now no one knew what really had happened, said Cuffy and Henry and God. They used the deck as a great big oven and barbecued Murray cod. Now Henry Blows is no longer a deckhand, nor did he melt or lose his job, because Cuffy and Worthy had both expired with the indo from barbecued cod. Oh, poor Henry Blows, how he did woe at the loss of such good friends. So they sent him a letter to make him all better. Dear Henry, you are now captain of Murray Explorer. The end.
From table 11, first of all, Tom sings a couple of songs we all know. Give Tom a big hand from table 11.
Ladies and gentlemen, I must apologise, and to our organist, I had arranged two beautiful love songs, but unfortunately I've got a hell of a cold at the moment, so I'm going to sing them, three Scottish songs in my own tongue, and possibly tell a Scottish yarn, and if I don't get hooked up with those police, I want to tell one Irish yarn, and both in the language that they should be spoken in, not like our friends. But the first song, as you know, when the baby is coming along, mother gets her needles out and starts knitting little singlets, and this, or little shirts as we used to call them in the old country.
Put your mic up.
And this song is concerned about the little wee shirt me mother made for me. And it goes something like this. Oh, I'll never forget the day that I was born. It was one winter's frosty morning. And the doctor said her heart was a chubby chap. As he laid me in the nurse's lap, after powder puffing me all over and dolling me up as you may see, they laid me in the cradle by the fireside, in the little wee shack me mother made for me. And then you went on a wee bit and you got a bit older, and you started to get into what we called in those days, and a lot of yous would know, knicker box. And this is what. Oh, I'll never forget the day that I first wore knicker box. It did feel so funny after wearing frocks. Me mother said, you may go and play, but be sure and not cross the way. Suddenly like the trousers I was wearing, so I took them off as you may see, started walking home quite bravely, and the little wee shirt my mother made for me. And then I got a wee bit older and started to go to work, and this is the wee bit of it. Going to work. Oh, I'll never forget when I first went to work. One day my boss said he had a lark. He said, you may have a holiday. So I went down to Newcastle to bathe. All the young ladies on the beach were standing staring, and some were even taking snaps of what they could see. It was a damnable good job for me that I was wearing that little wee shirt my mother made for me. Well, this is a wee Scottish yarn. It's about Jock and Jean. They live up in the Highlands of Scotland. And even today in the Highlands of Scotland, There's still places without electricity. So it means that you've got to use the old lantern like they used around here in the early days. You've got to use a lantern. So anyway, Jock and Jean were expecting their first baby. And Jean says, "Here, Jock," she says, "I think you better go into the village," she said, "and get the doctor." She says, "It's time." So Jock, off down to the village, and he got the doctor, and the doctor came up, and he made an inspection, and he said, "Aye, Jock, it's time. You'll have to hold the lantern." So Jock's holding the lantern, and the baby arrives. And he says, "Oh, Jock," he says, "it's a wee laddie." Jock says, "Oh, isn't that grand, a laddie?" He says, "Oh, that's magnificent." He said, "We'll have to have a celebration." So he gets the bottle of scotch out, and he's just about to open it. And Jean says, oh, Jock, oh, doctor," she says, "I think I'm going to have another one." So the doctor made an inspection, and he says, "Aye, Jock, get the lantern." He says, "There's another one, all right," he says. So that baby arrived, and it was a lassie. And Jock says, "Oh, isn't that grand?" He says, "I've got a pigeon pair. Oh, a wee laddie and a wee lassie." He says, "Oh, we'll have to have a double celebration." And he's quite thrilled about this. Just then Jean says, oh my God," she says, "I think there's another one." So the doctor makes an examination, and he says, "Aye, Jock, it's right," he says. "You better hold the lantern." Jock says, "Here, you better wait on a minute. Do you not think it's the lantern that's attracting them?" Because my grandparents were Irish, and I hope that nobody takes any offence, because there's a little bit about the churches in them, but there's nothing offensive, or I don't think so anyway. And it concerns Mick, our driver, and his brother Patrick, and they're digging a hole in the street outside a house of ill fame. And they're digging this drain for the water board, you see. So all of a sudden, the Methodist minister comes down the street, and he looks up and down, has a wee look, and he sneaks into this place. Patrick says, "Here, Michael, did you see that? A reverend gentleman like that going into a place like that." "Whatever is the word coming?" And Pat says, "Oh," he says, "I don't know, Michael," he says, "I don't know." So they're working away there, and the next thing was the Church of England minister comes down, and he says, "We think about him down the street," and into the same house he goes. So again, Pat says, "Look at that, Michael. Another reverend gentleman going in there." He says, "Oh, this is disgusting." He says, "Go into a place like that." And just then, Father O'Flaherty came down the street, and he says, "Hello, Michael. How are you, Patrick?" "Oh, we're fine, Father." And he had a little look up and down the street, and he went into that house, and Patrick says, "Do you know about that?" He
He says there must be somebody sick in there. Very good song, I think, and a place that's very close to my heart.
Paper down, come over here. He said, would you like to see an Aboriginal carving? No, he said, I've seen a cow carving once.